Kevin Markwick here again, and also Phil Lott. Hello, Phil.
Hello.
You're in here again. You're in Los Angeles, and I'm in Uckfield. It doesn't sound as good, does it? It just doesn't. It's not the same. But anyway, we got a good one this week, I think. I think the listener is going to enjoy this one, don't you?
I do, actually, really do.
So who have we got? Spill the beans.
We have, I'm going to say he's a friend of mine. He's also, separately to being a friend of mine, he's a fantastic composer called Scott Selinas. Fantastic composer in America. If you are not super familiar with some of his work, you have heard it, I promise you. It's been on loads and loads of movies and documentaries and films. Everything from Cartel Land, which is that amazing documentary about the drug cartels. This Sea of Shadows, which is the natural history documentary about the illegal trade in a fish. I can't remember his name, but you need to cut that out. But he's also done... I'm not going to go through the whole thing. Should I go through the whole thing? Should I give a few more?
Yeah, give me a few more titles.
Yeah. All right, here we go. The Ivory Game for Netflix. He's also done Earthrise, amazing documentary of... fantastic documentary called Lance, which, if you haven't seen, that's about Lance Armstrong. And then he's most recently he's just done a massive documentary on HBO called Tiger, about Tiger Woods. But in the meantime, he also did The Banker, which fantastic film. If you haven't seen it, check it out.
Right. I thought it was I loved talking to Scott. I think he's given us some real insight into how he composes, and actually his insight into other composers' scores, I thought was really fascinating.
It's a reason, and I met him professionally first before he became a friend, but through just listening to documentaries on television, I just one day saw one of the documentaries he'd made and just reached out, and sometimes that works. And he's done many shows with us right now. And just the way he works is just very intuitive, very thoughtful, and breaks it down in a way that you go, oh, I get it. I didn't realize that's why I like that piece of music. I didn't realize that's how that piece of music was working. And So it's at once sort of super emotional, but also incredibly thoughtful and technical in a way that is, you know, as you would expect from a craftsman.
Yeah, I learned a lot, actually, listening to him. I really did learn a lot. But okay, so what happened was we'll drop you into the conversation. We were just actually talking about American Beauty, the score by Thomas Newman, which we have a fascinating discussion on. So there you go. Have a listen. Hope you enjoy it. And we'll see you next time. Don't do it. Just say bye. Just say bye, Phil. Go on, say it.
Bye.
Phil. Hey! I literally grew up in that cinema, actually. My parents took it when I was barely 2 years old, so literally grown up in the cinema. I am the kid from Cinema Paradiso.
That's what I was thinking, yeah. Could have put that one on there. That one almost made the cut.
Yeah, yes.
That's incredible.
I can't go too near it too often because it just makes me blub too much. I just kind of... And we had this conversation recently, Phil and I, and as soon as I start talking about things that make me cry in movies, I start crying. It's a, I don't know, maybe I need some...
I'm a big crier.
Yeah, it's a nightmare, isn't it? So...
any of the scores you sent us cry worthy?
Yeah.
For me, that Angela Andress is... Mm. Thomas Newman one.
Yeah.
He cracked the code. I mean, now it's such a thing that we've heard so many times now because that became sort of the gold standard for emotion immediately. But the first time that came out, I was like, wait, oh, okay, you can do that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We can do emotion that way.
Yeah, it's funny. You know, when I saw the list, I was thinking, oh, I'm surprised that wasn't a Shawshank cue. But then I thought that perhaps that would be your answer. That is the idea. This is the genesis of the Thomas Newman sound.
Yeah, I think this is where it all starts. There's stuff before this where he's doing, well, I think he did Police Academy, but where he, let's skip that one, but he did this one called Unsung Heroes, I think it's called, where he's doing all this weird, he's already got the weirdness happening. He's recording George Deering on guitars, but running them through a half-speed tape machine, and he's starting to really get that weirdness happening, but I feel like his emotional vocabulary actually is the thing that puts him in a class all of his own. The way he deals with complex emotion, which in my opinion, the way he deals with it is by creating sort of music that's like emotional stem cells. And it differentiates into whatever it needs to differentiate in the context that you put it in, if that makes any sense. I wouldn't say it's neutral, because it's not safe. It's emotionally charged, his stuff, but it's kind of like whatever you want it to be is what it is. And he's the master of that. And I don't know anyone that was doing that before that I was aware of. And then that sort of became the gold standard for, you know, how to pull at the new way to pull at the heartstrings. Cause I think we were pretty maxed out on the old way, which is maybe like, you know, maybe like that Morricone piece, you know, that's the old way to pull it, which is awesome. I love that thing, but it's pretty cool because those are sort of trying to do a similar job. And I feel like that was the thing that Thomas Newman did, is he kind of reinvented that. And then he's been doing that, mining that for a long time.
It's interesting because is that the first of his scores that had that particular sound to it? I seem to think his scores before this, I'm no expert, as I keep hastening, keep pointing out, but his scores before that were a lot more conventional in their sound than American Beauty seemed to be a bit of a watershed for him.
Yeah, I think Unsung Heroes was in this direction, but nobody saw that. And then Police Academy, I have a feeling, was probably pretty not. Just straight ahead in the tradition of his family, like David Newman or some, you know, like he was kind of writing in that, like, you know, this is my lineage, like the more like a whatever, you know, traditional film score, still very competent, but not trying to like necessarily push the boundaries in any way.
No, and this broke out into the mainstream as well, didn't it? Which film scores sometimes don't. It broke out, you know, people would know what it was, even people who weren't movie fans or...
Right.
It was a hard one for me to choose because it's been in so many, you know, as a composer, I've run into this in so many temp scores in the edit where this is in there. Not necessarily this cue per se, but the more bouncy ones that are full of energy and you know, I forget the names of them, but those are in every single documentary temp score for about 15 years. So it's a hard score for me to choose from that reason, because there's a part of me that if you say American Beauty, I want to vomit just as a reaction. I have a personal vocational reaction to all the times I've been confronted with it. But there's a reason for that. And I do remember this score kind of just blew my mind. It made me feel, also personally, as someone who is going to be pursuing this field, it made me feel like there was room for new ideas and new, you know, it made me go like, oh wow, okay, there's a whole world out there.
So aside from the kind of the orchestration and the particular Thomas Newman sound that we're now very familiar with, what else was he doing in that soundtrack that you remember going, that's new?
It's also the aesthetic, the spotting aesthetic. When to play against things, and like also, like, if you like, stuff is incredibly layered, actually. Like, if you were to look at how many tracks some of these cues are, you wouldn't believe it, because he'll take like, he would take like 15 layers to make a thing that just sounds like a little ambient pad. But if you break that thing down, there's a million things going on in there. And I just, it kind of had a craftsmanship and an attention to detail. And it was like, whoa. It was almost like in fashion or something, if everyone was, you know, doing something for a long time and then suddenly someone came out in like flip-flops and a parka. I don't know. It was just like, wait, what the heck? For me, it had that effect on me. And you could see a lot of the other things that I choose might fall into a more traditional, you could call traditional. So I love that stuff.
But what do you think was a catalyst at that point for that departure, that change, that pushing the, I mean, the risk of torturing, pushing the envelope of making something so unique? Why, what was it about that film? Was it the film, do you think? Do you think it was the director?
I think it's the film and the Sandman and the director. I mean, but particularly the film, like if you watch the film, you know, I have a friend of mine that we were just somehow got on the, not a composer, the film, and he said he watched it again recently and he says the film doesn't age well.
Really?
And I thought that was really interesting. I don't actually necessarily agree with that sentiment per se, but it's an interesting point of view, which if we look at it differently, because that's kind of a judgment, if we look at it differently, it does sort of say that movie, much like a Pulp Fiction or something, it really is like a, feels like a marker in a point in time. And that movie, just forget about the music, changed things. It's so incredibly awkward and strange, and obviously the ending and it's very, you know, it was very provocative at the time. And, you know, now the whole Kevin Spacey thing, blah, 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 complicates it to a degree. But putting that aside, I think that I almost feel like there's a couple of, you know, there's a few films where it's almost like if you didn't have this score, the film would have failed. It's that important. Like, I think he was responding to something that he understood intuitively, that he had to go to a place that made people comfortable accepting that material and making it through to the end. Because the film is kind of like a, I don't want to say a farce, or it's a social critique. It's a lot of things more than whatever the story is. It's like a critique on society, you know? And I think that that score makes it not just palatable, but really potent. And I don't know if I can't even picture another score. It's one of those ones where I can't even imagine another score.
Thank you.
And that's the sequence, yeah. I believe, with the where it's the sort of creepy sequence, isn't it?
I believe so. Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's probably the most, ironically, to our conversation, it's probably the most "quote unquote" traditional
part
cue or thing in the score. But even that, now when we listen to it, it's that style has been sort of done so many times that I think we forget, like, that piano part is like, it's like hanging on for dear life. Like, there's absolute bare minimum amount of notes in that part to convey what's going on there melodically and harmonically. Like, it's almost like there was a more complex piece and then someone came in with an eraser and took away a bunch of notes. And because that's a waltz.
Little piece
of music, that's a waltz. It doesn't feel like a waltz because the waltzy things have been understated and removed. But like, and then it's on this bed of like emotionally charged, you know, liquid molasses that the more you dig into it, the more ingredients there are, but you're not even really paying attention to it. It just sweeps you away. And it's, I don't know. It just sort of, to me, it was like, oh, we can get at emotion, not just through melody, which this has, but through really interesting textures that maybe they're orchestral, maybe they're not. A little bit later from that excerpt, some strings come in and it sort of takes off. But still, like, what is, like, I love a score where I'm like, what the heck is that?
Great.
Instrumentation or sound, you know? And this one, it has that in spades. And other scores that are very, you know, just using the orchestra, the ones that attract me are the ones where they still manage to make me go, what is that blend or what is that doubling? Or how did he get that sound, you know?
Because actually we're seeing that more and more, aren't we? We're seeing a lot more interesting scores now, you know, like for Joker and for Arrival, which we'll come to later, and, you know, all that kind of stuff, which are not in any way traditional film scores. So there's all, you know, there's a chance that pushing of the envelope that he did then has led us to accept scores like Joker and things like that. Maybe that's overselling it a bit.
Go ahead.
I'm just going to jump in and say, I think that is, I will admit to having the pleasure of having worked with Scott many times now, and it is definitely something that you do. I mean, I'm not saying you've taken it from Thomas Newman, but it is something that, to create something that's so surprising and makes you question where it came from and what's it actually doing, it's a huge, genuine pleasure to kind of hear you kind of figuring it out and break
it
apart.
Yeah, it's a fun process.
Deconstruct.
So now we're going to listen to some of John Williams' score for Catch Me If You Can, which is one of the ones that you chose. Now, this is, for my money, one of John, again, it's not entirely a John Williams-y score, is it?
No, it's actually my favorite score of all time, and my favorite score of his, obviously, by process, whatever, by logic, whatever the word is.
But I remember the first time I heard it, it was, it stands out. When did we see it? Oh, actually, we saw it together, Phil. Do you remember?
Mm-hmm.
We saw it at the BAFTA screening in London. And as soon as it starts, it's just carries the film instantly, doesn't it?
And you don't have to have marimba or vibraphone in your score for me to like it, but I am just noticing it seems to be something that is in a lot of these, which I hadn't thought about until just now.
But given his wealth of film music, why this one? Why is this one your favorite?
So when I hear, as a composer, when I hear, as a film composer, when I hear a score that I really, really like or love, it usually falls into one of two categories, either sort of like, oh, that is so clever, I wish I thought of that. Kind of like someone who outwits you at a party and you find them very charming, or something that I just feel like is just way beyond something I would ever say or think of. You know, it just, it hits me in a way that it's like, that's not clever. That's just like, maybe like some, you know, rocket science going on there. And this score in particular, for me, the first time I heard it, it just felt like something I would never have thought. It was beyond like, hey, that's clever. It was like, I don't think in 1,000 years I would have thought of this. And I love it. There's a million things I wouldn't have thought of that I don't like. You know what I mean? And it just, the feeling was just like, it's the craftsmanship. And I'm partial to jazz personally, because I studied it a lot and I still play it and stuff. But it was just kind of like, it's, all of his stuff is virtuosic, but this one was virtuosic in a way that made me kind of go like, I don't know, I can bring it back to fashion again, like some just ridiculous couture dress with 1,000 beads on it, but that is actually really beautiful and not just some weird alien looking, you know. It's like a 10 out of in every category, in every Olympic category. I feel like that when the judges lift their cards, it's a 10 on style, it's a 10 on an event, you know. It's just tens across the board for me.
It's just interesting why he thought the material required that kind of score. That's kind of interesting, because he's sort of, you know, he's the god of gods and all that kind of stuff, I fully understand, but you know, he does tend to have, sorry, it was a bit dismissive, but well, I mean, he does he does often have a certain type of score that goes with a certain type of film, doesn't he? You know, you've got your bingley bongley Harry Pottery Witches of Eastwicky bingley bongley stuff, and then you've got the stuff, you know, for the American dream, and but this one seems to come out of nowhere in particular for him. I mean,
I think it has to do with his background, if I had to guess, as Henry Mancini. He was his piano player in a lot of those recordings. So this has to me, what's the classic? Why can't I think of that?
What, Henry Mancini score?
Yeah.
Pink Panther.
Pink Panther. Yeah. So like, this has, I think this is like, it's got 15% Pink Panther in it, but then it's done in the classy John Williams, like, I can later conduct this for the Boston Pops in a tuxedo and no one's going to laugh, you know, quality to it. But I think this is, sometimes I think of some of his scores, not as an FU, because I know he loved Mancini, but a little bit of like, oh, really? Here's actually, you know, like, here's the John Williams version. And so this score for me has that component. Like, for instance, it has an alto saxophone solo. The guy's a friend of mine, actually, who's playing. I've recorded him a million times, Dan Higgins. But that alto saxophone solo in the piece, if you're kind of a musician, it sounds like an improvisation, like a jazz improvisation. It is written down note for painful note. And in these Hollywood scoring sessions, these guys are so good, they just show up and sight read. He gave Dan that part 2 weeks before.
Right.
Dan doesn't need that. Dan's one of the best sight read. But I'm just saying, like, this is, there's no like you're gonna work on this, you there's know
nothing,
what I mean?
Right. Nothing random and about it.
No. And that's the thing I love about John Williams, that I have a lot more in my process, I have a lot more room for improvisation and happy accidents and, oh, look, these two things collided, I never would have known that would have happened. John Williams, everything in his brain. And there is no, I mean, if there is, it's very, very, very small. I mean, the one thing about his process that may allow for that is when he takes a long time to record, and when he's on the stage, he'll make changes. And if he doesn't like a cue, he goes home and he rewrites a whole brand new cue and shows up the next day with something completely, like, someone was telling me some stories on one of these Star Wars films, like, no one was even complaining about the cue. He just decided he didn't like it, and he went home and wrote like a, you know, 8-part fugue or something for the cue the next day. So he does have, it's not that he can't reevaluate what he's doing and make changes, but generally speaking, his ideas are 100% fully formed. Whereas I don't operate that way. That's another thing that for me puts him in this kind of rocket science virtuosic pedestal is just what his brain can hold all at once. My brain needs, I need to play, you know what I mean? And I'm like in the sandbox playing with like toys, and you know, he's like designing something like an architect. I don't think it actually matters, you know. That's why I love composing, is because it's not a competition of what you can do in real time, like maybe being like a jazz performer. It's like, that's like almost being like an athlete. Like, right. How high can you jump? Right. How fast can you play? What can your processor do in real time? In composing, like, it's just like when you decide to put your pencil down, where do you land? And if that takes you 10 years or 10 minutes, nobody cares.
No.
Right. I mean, I guess John Williams and Mancini and the fathers before them came from the studio system. So they were having to churn out a movie a week. Or something crazy like that. So I guess that discipline was something that they were just born into.
And it's the fastest way to write. It's, I mean, now the way we work, not to get bogged down, but you know, it's a crutch and a tool, but we essentially have to, even if you're working with an orchestra, you have to pre-simulate everything, get it approved, and then you go record the orchestra, and it's still way better, but there's no big surprises there. In fact,
right, you mean you're literally recording just. For folks who don't know, you're literally talking about people. You have to record with as electronic synth sort of orchestra.
Exactly. You have to simulate the idea, and then it's completely formed. And that process of simulating an idea is much slower, even if you're fast at it, than writing an idea on a page. And even if you want to like develop a theme, it's much easier to go, oh well, what if I took these notes and put them over here? And then, you know, it's actually the best way to, still the best way to make music if you can, would be just to sit there with a piece of paper and then, you know, hand that off to an orchestra and then see what happens. And, you know, that is the best, that is the fastest. It's just in our world, it doesn't work anymore, that setup, really. It's very rare. Like even John Williams on some of his last films working with J.J. Abrams, he had to hire a mock-up artist. He had to hire a guy to take his scores, run off on a computer and simulate them to play them for J.J. Abrams. He just wasn't, you know, so there's good and the bad with that. The good of that is it means we can, okay, now that we're in there, we can play around and very speed things and mess around with different sounds. And there's a recording, producing, sound design. You'll hear that in like something like Arrival, you know, or like you said, The Joker. So I think that, you know, people who look at that as an opportunity tend to excel. I mean, I also do crazy things, like if I'm working with someone for the first time, I'll sometimes just spend my own money and go record some players anyway and just present my first ideas as fully formed, because I don't want an idea to get rejected because I couldn't get there with the with the limited tools that I have to express it.
Also, the other thing that you were talking about earlier was the temp score, which is a blessing and a curse, right?
Yeah, I mean, the way I look at temp scores, because they're there and they're necessary, we're not going to get away from them. There's two ways to deal with it. The most preferable way is let the temp score be you. In other words, get on the project so early, script stage, you know, or if it's a doc, whatever, early, and start writing stuff, start making stuff, so that when they finally get down to the edit, when they're reaching for their bin of things to choose from, it's already original music that could be drawn from. It's probably never going to get you all the way there. I mean, Hans actually did it with Inception. That's like a classic example. He wrote all the music before, or most of it, and recorded it, I think. I don't know. But so Brokeback Mountain is done that way. So then there's the hybrid of that. That only gets you so far because you only had so much time, but you can still also then curate the temp. So if I don't have time to make it, I can say, well, here's my vision board, or, you know, like an interior decorator who would come in with their, you know, their collage, or, you know, or like, you know, here's these like Italian tiles that you can't afford, but here's these ones from, you know, Home Depot that look almost the same, that, you know, whatever. So that you have an influence, so that you don't just show up to a film and it's just filled with a temp and you didn't have any influence over that. That's the hardest situation. So I just try to get in there early and shape it with original stuff, maybe stuff of mine, or who knows, Angela Undressed. Like, I don't actually have a problem with having other composers' music in the temp. I feel like more information is more information. We're all adults here, you know, and in the end, the way you beat a temp, let's say a scene where it was cut to this piece of music, the music is a 10 out of a 10 anyway, and the scene is now a 10 out of 10. The only way to beat that when you're confronted with that is to do the thing that the temp cannot do, which is to relate to the rest of the score. So the way you beat a 10 out of a 10 temp in a scene is you have to have themes that you've developed, and now those themes logically and make sense that X theme should be in that spot, and then the temp can serve as an inspiration for instrumentation or tempo or feel. But like, once the director is in love with the themes, they're going to actually find that temp to feel like kind of like an anomaly, like, you know, their love for it will start to fade. And then you can beat it. Not necessarily you're going to write a better piece of music, but you can beat it in the context of the film and, you know, how it relates to everything and how it functions. It's the cat and mouse.
Right. And it's jazz. He's making up as he goes along.
Yeah.
He's improvising, I guess.
Well, no.
Yes.
He's improvising, or he's not improvising?
Like it.
Oh, you mean the character?
No, actually, the character,
the character is improvising. Yeah. Yeah, well, that makes a lot of sense, too. Because, yes, he has no... I mean, that's what's partly brilliant about DiCaprio's performance, isn't it? It's the fear behind his eyes the whole time that at any moment he's going to... In fact, as actually one of the themes of the film is that he actually wants to be caught, isn't it?
Yeah.
And it's one of those annoying films that you, when it's on the TV, you think, oh, I'll just watch this bit because I like this bit. Oh, and I'll just watch this bit because I like this bit. And you end up sitting and watching the whole blinking movie because it's so compellingly put together. Okay, so what's next? We've got some James Horner from A Beautiful Mind, which could be describing me, but it isn't in this instance. So let me play that, actually. Here we go. We'll have a bit of that first, and then we can discuss it.
Thank you.
guy who's not afraid of some chords.
No.
You know, full disclosure, I went to Princeton where this takes place, but I don't think that's the reason why I like it. It might be, secretly be, but one of the things that always impresses me about a score is when the composer can, in a very short amount of time, establish the world of this of the movie. Hans Zimmer isn't on this list, but I think he is probably the number one master of that, of like,
for sure,
25 seconds of score and the whole world has been established, whatever it is. And I feel like a kaleidoscope of mathematics. I mean, this is about a guy who's a math genius, but is also suffering from mental illness. And I remember the first time I saw this movie and heard this music, I just remember thinking, that's exactly the right way to approach this. It's beautiful, it's complex, and it's bold, and it's not afraid of itself, and it's a little ADD. Mm-hmm. It's like, right, goes from, right, one thing to another, hanging on for dear life, but there's a logic behind it. I just feel like the one of the things I really like about James Horner, especially during this period, is he doesn't seem like a guy that's suffering from writer's block. Or like, what should the next measure be? Like, there's a freedom in the writing, a sort of cavalier quality to it. It's still very, you know, professional and competent and organized and everything's correct. But like, there's a sort of like, I do what I want. Kind of.
Totally. Yeah.
Yeah. Like a confidence in the idea, swagger, like kind of sort of, even though this is kind of a clunky, slightly quirky piece of music, especially for back then, it's super confident and it always attracted me to it. And there's another one of those, like a lot of these, the effect that they have on me when they're inspiring is sort of like, oh, it's always like kind of an epiphany, like, oh, so you could do whatever you want. Like, it just sounds like a guy who's doing whatever he wants and nailing it. But like a lot of times when you hear scores, it doesn't sound like the guy was doing whatever he wanted. It sounds like he barely survived a POW camp or something and was being tortured the whole time and made it through. And there's a score there somehow still, you know,
it's a process.
Yeah. But I mean, I would imagine that all films have their stories, don't they, of how they finally arrive at where they are. And that can't be any different. Right. That can't be any different for the score. I mean, I can't imagine that every single film, James Horner turns up, everyone goes, yep, that's fine, James, lovely. They record it and they all go home and everybody's happy. You know, I can't imagine that, you know, that's...
That's right. But this one, even though it may not have been that process, this might have been his 10th idea.
Yeah.
It felt like that to me when I heard it. It felt like it didn't feel like a committee got to this one.
Well, I guess, like, I mean...
He hit a home run, right?
It was either his first idea or the idea at the end when he said, okay, everyone just leave me alone. Go away now.
But I guess, you know, I mean, he was coming off the back of the Oscar for Titanic and things. I mean, he's cute, you know, he was pretty well respected, well, even before that. But, you know, you would like to think once you got to a status like that, you could do what you like, couldn't you? I don't know. Am I being naive?
At least for a couple of years.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, maybe I'm being naive. But
I mean, this is one of those scores I remember listening to and thinking, I'm about to get a speeding ticket because of this score.
Oh, really? What?
And it's like, I'm not sure it's a valid excuse to a policeman, but I'm being chased by the FBI. I'm having visions. I'm counting a lot.
Oh, okay. Really?
It's not good enough. Yeah. It's not good enough.
I see what you did there.
But I think it's also the natural tension in it, which... Even though it's beautiful and it's got the female voices in it, it's still filled with tension. There's something happening else. Something else is happening.
I have to say, it's not a film I've revisited. It's not a film I've gone back to since I saw it when it came out. It's not a film that I'm drawn back to. Maybe I should go and have another look. I don't know. But
It's kind of a hard film to watch.
Yeah.
Because you're just watching someone slowly go mad, and Russell I think it's Russell Crowe, right?
I couldn't look in the mirror for that. I don't need to see it.
Yeah, exactly. I know, it's not necessarily one you're dying to watch again.
No, it doesn't strike me as that, no. But anyway, so what should we do next? I tell you what, let's go to the maestro, Morricone.
Yeah.
Now, Once Upon a Time in America, which, again, I think it's quite good that we play them and then talk about them.
Yeah.
So we'll have a quick listen.
Another, you know, another one where it's like, this guy does what he wants. You know, like when you listen to any Morricone score and it's like there's so much confidence and intention behind it. And I don't know, like, I mean, this one is just strings. It actually demonstrates that almost the least. But like we all know his everyone knows something of his. And the thing that you know of his is something really bold. And now people use it, try to imitate it in commercials, like. If there's a standoff between two people, there's an automatic score for that now. Like that is because of him. That's incredible. Yeah. Like he owns a situation, you know, he covered that situation so well that now whenever we're in that situation, the good, the bad, and the ugly or whatever owns that situation. Yeah. Like you're almost always referencing that in some way or avoiding doing it. Like it, like he's gotten to a point where the reference is either, Danny Elfman is a little bit like this too. The reference is either we want Morricone or we want not Morricone. It's a binary op, you know, it's a binary option. And you know, it's like, it's either, you know, like that, Danny Elfman is, it's like either they, you know, I can't tell many times, it's like we don't want Danny Elfman or we want Danny Elfman, but it's like it's one of those flavors that's like start out by defining whether you want it or not, and then we can go to the next conversation. It's like the first question.
And it's interesting because when you saw him interviewed, I mean, he did not lack for confidence, did he, at all, Morricone? No. He was very aware of his talent, and that's definitely reflected in the music. And this was such a wonking great film.
This piece in particular for me is like a master class in sort of melodic development. It's the thing you hope to be able to do, like when you write a melody, is to that the melody feels inevitable. But that you couldn't have predicted it.
Yes.
Like, which seems like a paradox, right? But once you've heard it, you're like, oh, of course that's what the melody is. But right before you've heard the next phrase for the first time, you're not sure what it's going to do.
Well, and this is it. Yes, this is like the, what do they call it? Is it the Aristotelian thing? At the risk of sounding like an arse? I think it was Aristotle, yeah, that came up with this idea that there is the perfect version of what it is you are trying to create out there. And unfortunately, it has to filter itself through you to get to the page.
That's right. And we can only mess it up.
Yeah, but I think it was when I heard that the first time many years ago, I thought that perfectly describes the creative process, is that in your mind, the perfect version is existing, and you can almost touch it, but unfortunately it has to go through you to come out the other end.
Yeah, whenever I finish a spotting session on a film, which is the very beginning before you've written anything, I always say, well, this is the best the score will ever sound, because you know, you've spent 8 hours talking about what the music could be.
Yeah,
you know, and it's like it's at its best right now. But yeah, and I feel like he did a pretty darn good job of not messing with that perfection too much on this one. And the way it sort of unravels, like this theme unravels, like you're opening a box, and then there's another box inside of it, and it keeps growing and growing. But it's like,
but how much do you think, because I mean, most, if they're lucky, film composers are fairly prolific, aren't they? You know, they're doing a lot of work a lot of the time.
Yeah.
And, you know, I can't keep up with it. I look at a James Horner or whatever, and you think, well, goodness, look at them all. Look at them all. Yeah. You know, and I can't be an expert in it, in all of that stuff. But Morricone outlooked them all, didn't he? I mean, he was so prolific. Do you think there was an element that actually that fed into his scores? He didn't have time to muck about. He just had to get in there, write something beautiful, and move on to the next one. I don't know. Or is that? Do you think that does him a disservice?
No, I think that process. I mean, no, as in yes, I agree with you. That process, I think, when you don't have time for fear. You know, you do your best work. It's really like writer's block or fear. It's just fear, right? Fear of failure, fear of being, you know, found out that you're a fake, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
That's the thing that's the killer. That's the creation killer. And then when you, and that fear, it starts out as just a sort of childish sort of insecurity, paranoia, but it can be incredibly amplified when you're surrounded by people that also don't believe in you. Like, someone had to hire you because they couldn't get the guy they wanted, or the studio reluctantly, you know, when it's like, when not every, when everyone is not on board necessarily in the committees of people, once you get on these big blockbustery things, there's almost always a quiet naysayer behind your back. So like the fear is actually well-founded. There are people that want, that are expecting you to fail. And then you have time, you know, maybe you have a couple of weeks to come up with your theme, you know, and it's just, I think that navigating that territory is the thing that makes the sort of Hollywood greats really stand out. Whatever is their method for it. Hans Zimmer has one method. Thomas Newman has another method. I think he's like, I don't want to see any temps. I don't think he's big. You know, everyone has their way of negotiating it. John Powell, who's one of my favorite composers, he was a late bloomer, and his method was, I'll just write any scene 20, 25 times, completely new ideas, because I'm so lucky to be here. I feel like I'm learning on the job. Like, he had a very big career in ad music, and then quickly his sort of film career took off with Face Off and a couple of these movies. And so his thing was, I'll just always do every revision. And you know, and so I feel like Morricone, I'm guessing because he was in a different system, and his bravado and who he is, you know, he was kind of, and was able to maintain that through his career. Kind of like what it reminds me of is kind of like Motown or something, like the way they made records in Motown. Everybody was incredibly competent. Mm-hmm. And they came in and they just made a record one day. You know what I mean? And then next record.
And by the way, who's going to give him a note?
Well, Morricone. Well, right. Not by that point.
And so I do kind of agree. Like, there's a sort of a... What I think there is there's a purity of thought, you know? And also his stuff, it's not actually very layered. Like, this piece sounds huge. If you were to look at it on the page, there's nothing happening. There's a low drone, you know, being played by the basses. They're holding one note, and then these strings are like playing two parts in the beginning. It's just like, if you look at it, you know, the big orchestra page, everything's down at the bottom. There's nothing for the top two thirds of the page, and then the bottom there's like a couple of things going on, but it's the biggest thing you ever heard. So I think that's the other thing is, him and John Williams and these guys that had to go fast, they also become masters of what is the bare minimum of elements that actually make something sound complete. Mm. And I think Morricone is a master of that. Like, he's not scared of any weird sounds or any unusual elements, but like, there aren't actually that many things going on usually in his music at any given one moment. And that's kind of bold, and also maybe born out of necessity. But I really admire that, as opposed to like a John Williams or even Danny Elfman or Hans Zimmer or Thomas Newman. Those guys have actually so many layers. I mean, Danny Elfman is probably the craziest. You could mute like 75 of the tracks, and then you'd have just a completely different piece of music that would also be good.
Right.
So I think that's, for me, just like, being able to cook a great meal with four or five ingredients that just makes your mouth water and you cry. That's his specialty. And that's brilliant. And that's very Italian, I feel like.
I mean, the sense of an alien presence in that music is palpable, isn't it?
It's unbelievable.
You know, it's Jonas Johansson and his score for Arrival, who is a big loss. I think we're missing out on a lot of stuff there. But this one particularly is, quite something.
What I like about Johan is, R.I.P., is he can write this, but he could also write something very much in that style of that beautiful mind. Theory of everything.
Yes, very
traditional. That score is living in that space, you know, in a kind of Desplat space, you know, like...
Totally, yeah.
He's very, very happy there too, and writing beautiful stuff. So he's a very difficult one to choose one score from, because, and he's someone that I really admire, because I actually fancy myself that way too. Like I'm not a sort of a one sound. Some of my favorite composers are pretty one vibey, like Trent Reznor and. You know, other, although he's always trying to stretch, but you know, like, you know, you're getting, you know, like that, or even Thomas Newman, like, oh, that's a Thomas Newman score. You can hear it.
Right.
I'm always trying to find new things and new ways of doing things. And I don't even like a lot of my composer friends in this electronic world that we live in, they hit a button when they come to work and this giant template with 1,000 tracks opens up and every sound is at their fingertips. When I open up and I start on a new score, there's nothing there. Like, it's blank. And then I start making stuff and then it snowballs over time. By the time I get to the end of the process, I do have this unwieldy thing that, you know, that has to do with that score. But I don't really like starting with the same palette or anything like that. And I can definitely tell Johan was always pushing himself. And this one also, the idea that within 20 seconds or 15 seconds of listening to something, the entire world of that film is established. I mean, this is like a perfect example of that. And he's doing it with very little, you know?
Yeah. What is it? Just a voice and a...
Could be a voice. I mean, half the time I have no idea how he's making these sounds. The drone sounds to me like it's made out of metal, actually, which is when you slow it down and smear it, metal has so much interesting colors to it. Like the sound of hitting a cymbal.
Mm-hmm.
If you were to take the part after you hit the cymbal, not the hitting it part, and stretch that 1,000 times so that in that one instant, that could last for 10 minutes. That's how you get a sound. Awesome. That's how you get a sound like that drone. Doesn't mean that's how he got it, but that's one way to get it. Like this, he's really good with manipulating stuff.
Mm.
The other thing for me about this score as it applies in the film is, you know, the sort of, it's a monster movie, right? What's a monster movie, right? And, you know, when do you get to see the monster is always the big question in any monster movie. And I think that also applies to the score.
Oh, absolutely.
Like and I think he's a masterful job of when do these creepy sounds, when are they allowed to enter and when does he take it up a notch? And it's very easy when you're living in a world like this to just like in the first 10 minutes of the movie, show all your cards musically. And then like, oh, now what do I do? So it's like the restraint in this minimalistic approach to understand, you know, almost like a great EDM track where they somehow know, okay, if everyone is on ecstasy, this is the moment where they're going to get bored. So I have to change something right here, but not before that moment will I change anything. I feel like that aesthetic of knowing when to bring in the next thing, you know, not just in a piece of music, but on a whole scale of a film. I think, you know, he was really a master of that. Another great example of him nailing that is Sicario. Like Sicario gets used as a tempo lot as his driving sort of primal drum beat and these weird orchestral effects. But if you watch the film, it takes a while before that comes in. I mean, I can't say for certain, but I would say definitely past the halfway mark.
Yeah, I seem to remember the real driving stuff comes literally with the bit of the where they go over the border and drive that.
It's late, right?
Yeah, that's quite late.
I feel like it's kind of late in the film. And that sort of, I find that very admirable, because that's A, hard to keep in your brain and do right. And it's also hard to, or challenging to convince the people that you're working with that's right. How, you know, like it, that shows to me not only a successful sort of a creative approach, but maybe also that might have taken some convincing, or who knows, maybe he was going nuts and that we all the credit goes to the director, you know what I mean? However the process was, it came out right. And that level of like sort of discipline and patience in watching how things unfold. I think that's one of the things that makes a master film composer. Again, Hans is a master of that as well. Like, he knows when to go big, when to go small, and it's not always where you think. Sometimes it's opposite, you know.
He clearly has a good relationship, or had a good relationship with Villeneuve, and understood.
Yeah.
And they kind of obviously understood, because actually his score for Prisoners is beautiful. It's a beautiful score.
Incredible.
There's a cue on that. I think it's called Snow Falling or something, which is just wonderful. Nothing like this other stuff, you know. Nothing like Arrival or.
If it's a talk about temp music, I think that may have been Scott scored a series for us, Cold Case Files. I think it may have been the first one. You did for us, and that was our temp score. Prisoners.
From Prisoners. Yeah,
that's right.
Sorry about that. No, if we're really bad, I'll give you a temp score.
I love the challenge.
Yeah, but similarly to your point about challenge, that's the Arrival. I will sometimes put on a timeline to challenge myself to try and cut a scene worthy of that score, to try and cut something that would be a little less expected.
Yeah, the rhythms are not obvious in that, are they? Let's be honest. Certainly to somebody like me, the absolute idiot. You know, the rhythms are not not apparently obvious. But yes.
Well, it's nice the Mogwai had grew up and was able to do vocals on something else.
The Mogwai. Oh, Mogwai. Mogwai's a band, isn't it?
It's the Gremlin. Is that Gremlins?
Yeah.
Mogwai. That's a band, isn't it? Mogwai.
Well, yeah. It probably is now, but it's a Gremlin.
I'll tell you what we do.
It's a Gremlins before water.
So we're running at about just over an hour now. So by the time I cut the music in, we're going to be getting to about an hour and a half, which is more than any human man, person, woman needs to listen to our voices. So I tell you what, I mean, because the point is about this, isn't it, Scott? That if you start to pick your favorite scores, it can go on forever. It just literally can go on forever. And the beauty of them is that, and Phil and I talk about this a lot, is that certainly when I was young, and it was the same for Phil, the only way to own any part of the film was the film score. Because, I couldn't buy videos. They didn't exist. That's how old I am. You couldn't get the VHS of a film. The only way you could own a film was on either 16mm, impossible, or Super 8. And they were like £500 for a feature. It was the only way you could, $600-$700 for a feature. So the only way to own a film, to have a remembrance of the film, was to own the score or to buy the record. And, what's the point I'm making about that? So they're very important to us, which is why we wanted to do all this and talk to you. And it's been brilliant, brilliant talking to you about this. I could do it all day.
Really great.
To be honest, you know.
Really great.
And the insight as well that you've given me, certainly, because as a fan, that's all I am. I'm not, I'm nothing other than that. So I thought what we do is we finish on Gabriel Yared's score for The Talented Mr. Ripley. And why did you pick this one as opposed to, say, the one that everybody probably knows slightly better,
English Patient,
The English Patient, which is also very beautiful.
A couple of reasons. One, I just know this score better. You know, I've seen The English Patient once or twice, but this is a movie I keep coming back and watching over and over again, maybe every 5 years. And I watch it to go, is it really as good as I remember? And every time I go, yep, I love this movie. It's a brilliant film. And then for me, the thing that the score does, we keep coming back to this, like, establishing a world in a piece of music. I love films where the tone is very complicated. American Beauty is a great example, right? As a complicated tone where you have, and the music is a huge part in nailing that tone. And this is a complicated film tonally, because we're essentially rooting for a con man for a good part of the film. You know, eventually, you know, depending on your own personality, wherever that stops for you, you know, maybe it doesn't. But right. And that, you know, when the bad guy is the good guy, and then this sort of like frolicking on the beaches of Europe and decadence mixed with, you know, psychological trauma, and, you know, I just, this, all the bucket of stuff that the ingredients that are in the film, they're all here in the music. And yeah, I am a little partial to things that are jazzy, of course. Mm. And maybe jazz lends itself to sort of some of these more sophisticated vocabularies, at least from my perspective, because there's more notes to choose from in jazz. Things get more complex and they stack up more than they do in other sort of styles. But
I'll be honest, I hadn't heard
this. Great melody.
Yeah, I hadn't heard it for a long, 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 long time. It's a film I don't go back to. And I've been playing this playlist all day, because obviously you're on LA time, I'm on London time, and I've had all day to listen to this. And that's the one I went, oh my goodness, how have I not been going back to that? Because it's just wonderful. It really is.
It's an incredible piece of music, that particular theme. And again, this is one of those ones for me that it ticks all the boxes. You know, like it's composing wise, it's very virtuosic.
Mm-hmm.
It's also a guy that's doing what he wants, a guy or a gal that's doing exactly what they want to do, but not because he only had 10 minutes to do it. Sat around a long time and still did exactly. You know what I mean? Similar to Catch Me If You Can, this has a level of sophistication and, you know, like he stuck the landing style points, you know, gymnast. I don't know why I'm coming to like gymnastic and ice skating, but you know, like, Even the choice of outfit was good in the routine. You know, it's just like all the tens go up for me on however you want to judge a score. Memorable, taking you to the place, evocative, original, complex, but for the right reasons.
I was just looking at his other scores: English Patient, Map of the Human Heart, Possession. Wow. Troy. That sounded like a very Hans Zimmery type thing. If you'd ask me who composed the music for Troy, I'd say Hans Zimmer. That shows you how much I know.
Well, that's the old temp scores.
I don't know
anything about the process, but I had to guess.
Well, it had the voices.
It had the gladiatory.
Yeah, we did have to put up with a lot of elegiac voices, didn't we, over that period?
Yeah.
Lifting us to heaven. But okay, so we'll play out with the Ripley music. But thank you, Scott. It's absolutely fantastic. Thank you for
thank
your time.
Thank you so much.
You know,
Scott,
I mean, so like enjoyable. I say, we could have done this all day.
I know. But really great. Thank you.
But
guys.
I've got to. I'm now going to go and watch Brighton lose to Fulham. Now that's a very English thing to do.